Okay, so what makes a good sample for geochronology or thermochronology, and how do you go about sampling? The first and most important thing that you need to take into consideration when you're doing this is that the rock you're sampling is in situ or in place. It's really tempting, especially when you're in a big, rugged, steep terrain like this, to just go to the bottom of a cliff and find a boulder and take it home and Bob's your uncle. Unfortunately though, for what we want to do, the position of the rocks is exceedingly important. So not only are we going to come to an outcrop like this and make sure the rocks are in place, and we're going to do that by examining the strike and dip of foliations, look at geologic maps and make sure that everything makes sense. But we're also going to make sure that we record exactly where the rock is on a map, maybe with a GPS device, something like that. The second important thing is to make sure that your rock is nice and fresh. Sometimes you won't know until you get back to the laboratory whether your rock is fresh, but you can also usually tell just by hitting it with a hammer. If a rock is weathered, if it's been, if rainwater and other things have kind of degraded it over time, it'll sometimes have a dry thud sound, and that's just not what you want. You want that nice high ringing hammer hard rock sound. And then of course the other important thing is to make sure that you're sampling a rock that has the minerals in it that you want to date. So for some geochronology methods, like the potassium argon method I was talking about, the minerals that you are going to be dating are usually fairly large and fairly abundant. So in this chunk I have here, there's a whole bunch of little black biotites, and I can just see that with the naked eye. And that's because biotite in this case is what's called a rock-forming mineral. It's one of maybe four or six minerals that make up 99% of the volume of this rock. But it turns out that a lot of the minerals that we care about for these methods are what are called accessory phases. Accessory minerals are minerals that are ubiquitous, so they occur everywhere, but they make up a very, very small percent of the total rock volume, and even with a really powerful hand lens or magnifying glass, I couldn't see them in the rock right now. So based on the lithology of this, based on knowing that what type of rock it is, I have a pretty good idea that it will probably contain apatite and zircon. It's usually just based on experience, but it also means that in an area like this, where there are a variety of lithologies, I'll actually sample a variety of different rock types, so that if one of them doesn't have apatite and zircon in it, the other one might. So what I'm going to do to sample this is I'm going to find a nice piece that is in place, that seems nice and easy to sample, so it's not a glacially polished surface, but it actually has a little ledge underneath it already. It seems fresh, it's the right lithology I want. I have my chisel, I have my hammer, I have my safety glasses, and I'm recording the position, and so I'm going to go ahead and try to sample this rock here. Okay, so I've managed to break apart this larger slab into some smaller pieces. So I'm sampling again for these accessory minerals. What I typically will do for a rock like this is aim for around a couple kilograms. So that's like a muskmelon size sample. I'm going to try to actually break it apart in the field here because the process we're going to go through back in the lab requires me to start with kind of walnut sized chunks of rock. And if I do it here, I don't have to worry about contamination. I don't have to worry about anything else. I can just break it apart and put it in the bag, and it makes the process back in the lab a lot quicker. What I'm also going to do then is make sure that I record not just the location information about the rock that I have with the GPS and the maps, but I'm going to record a lot of field observations about the rock to make sure that when I'm back in the lab or back in my office and I have 100 samples from this summer, that I can actually refresh my memory about which one this one actually is. You can see what I have here then is I have a GPS that is recording my location and elevation. We care about position and elevation a lot. I have my field notebook that I'll be filling out in a minute. I have a camera over there that I'll be using to take pictures, and I have my labeled sample bag. You'll notice that this label here, RGD17-2, we as a field group decided what our naming scheme would be. And this is actually really important if you have multiple people collecting multiple samples for multiple problems. So this is the second sample that we've collected on this field excursion. I like these cloth bags or heavy plastic bags because we don't want to contaminate our samples with each other. Again, I'm going to be looking for tiny little minerals that exist in these rocks, and so any contamination at all can really screw up our observations. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to break these into little walnut-sized pieces. I'm going to fill up this bag with about 6 pounds worth of it. I'm going to tie it up, and I'm going to start making my observations.